The question was asked that Sunday morning, where is God? The pastor was sitting on the steps, and you'll find out in a little bit why I don't do that. He was sitting on the steps, the children gathered around him, and he was talking to them, and he said, where's God? Well, there was a silence. He thought, well, maybe they didn't understand it. Where is God? Again, I'm sure it was contemplative silence. Finally, one little boy raised his hand. He said, thank you, Johnny. He said, would you tell us where God is? And he said, yes, sir. He said, God is in the bathroom at my house. Well, see, you never ask questions that you don't know what the answer is going to be. But he said, God's, and of course, he had to ask. He said, well, why did you say God was in the bathroom at your house? And he said, well, this morning, my mom and my dad and me and my big sister, we were getting ready for church. And he said, I was standing at the door going into the garage, and I heard Daddy beating on the bathroom door saying, good God, get out of there. We're going to be late again. See, we got to think about what we say. Where is God? And so we want to talk about that today. Where is God? We want to do it as we continue our series on Show Me the Glory. And we're going to do that in talking about the presence of God. Now, we're all familiar with the idea of the presence of God, but I think we need to look a little deeper into it and see what it really is. So we're going to do it with several verses of Scripture, but the one we want to jump off with and where we want to start today, I hope this verse changes your life. I think this was a pivotal point in the life of Moses. And I think this can be a pivotal point in your life and a pivotal point in the life of this church. So as we talk about where is God, the presence of God, would you stand with me as we read Exodus chapter 33, verses 14 through 16. Now the picture here, God is talking to Moses. God, you'll remember God, Moses has gone up to receive the Ten Commandments. He comes back down. He finds the people worshiping a golden calf. God's upset, to say the least. And he and Moses, of course, Moses is upset, and they're having this conversation. God is telling him that he's going to lead the people and to continue on. God tells him this in verse 14. He says, then he replied, my presence will go with you and I will give you rest. Now listen to Moses' response. If your presence doesn't go, don't make us go up from here. How will it be known that I and your people have found favor in your sight unless you go with us? I and your people will be distinguished by this from all the other people on the face of the earth. Lord God, we thank you for your word. Lord, we want to understand today what it means to have your presence. So would your Holy Spirit, who is here, teach us today. Show us your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In dealing with the presence of God, we want to start with the fact that the Bible, put it simply, God is everywhere. God is everywhere. The theological term that we would use for that is the term omnipresence. He is everywhere at once. There's no place that you can find that God is not at. He is all over the place. Now that ought to give us comfort, and it probably should scare us if we think about some of the places we've been and some of the things we've done. God is everywhere. He is There are no space limitations for him. He is infinite, and in that infinite, he transcends all time and all space, and so he's filling every part of the universe at the exact same time. All of the universe knows his fullness to the point of his omnipresence, and it is not diffused anywhere. So I know there are some places we can go to in the world that we feel like, boy, this is an ungodly place. But let me tell you something, God is there. I saw a Facebook post this morning, a friend of mine who's got a mission team in his church, and they today have flown back. And if you know anything about flying from Africa, it's a multiple day trip. God was in Africa when they were there. God was in Washington, D.C., believe it or not, when they landed. And God is in Dallas when they landed here a few minutes ago. So God is everywhere, and because they left Africa and came over here, it doesn't mean he wasn't in Africa anymore. He's still there. The omnipresence of God. Jeremiah in chapter 23, verse 24, God declares, "Do I not fill the heavens and the earth?" We often call this building the house of God, but we must we not confess with Solomon the way he looked at it when he had completed the temple. In 1 Kings 8, 27, he said, "But will God indeed live on earth? Even heaven, the highest heaven, cannot contain you, much less this temple that I've built." So we've got to answer with a resounding yes. God is everywhere, and that ought to be exciting for us. That ought to be comforting for us to know that there is no place that you can go, no place I can go, that God's not already there, and he won't remain there. So that means that no one can take you out of the presence of God. There is nobody on this earth, no group of people that can remove you from the presence of God. Heard a testimony just this week of an Indian priest who grew up. He was born into, and he's actually now the payroll of our state convention, working with people groups to do missions. But he said, I was born into this upper Brahmin caste in Hind, and he said, "Here I am, never heard the name of Jesus, and somehow he got hold of part of the book of John, and he was reading there, and he said, as I read, Jesus said, 'I chose you, you didn't choose me.'" And he said, "Here's this man I've never heard of, but I knew at that moment he was talking about me." At the age, I think it was at 11, he was kicked out of his home. His mother kicked him out. His brother kicked him out, put him on the streets. And he said, "But I came across somebody with Campus Crusade, and they gave me a Bible, and I started reading, and I started understanding what it was to have this man named Jesus who called me." Listen, folks, he is in the countries where the Hindus are at, and there's no mention of the name of Jesus. Jesus met him in a Brahmin home, and he accepted Christ. Don't have time to tell the whole story, but years later, his mother invited him back, thought she would find someone that was destitute, and when he came back home, he looked better than he did when he left. She said, "How did you make it on your own?" He said, "I wasn't on my own. Jesus was with me." He shared Christ with her. His mother accepted Christ. His brother accepted Christ. His brother is now the pastor of the home church in her home. Let me tell you, God is everywhere. That is the omnipresence of God. Anywhere you go, he's there. That means if you're on top of a mountain peak, like Richard and Mary are today, God's there. If you're on a still lake, a glassy lake somewhere, God's there. Now that doesn't mean, don't go there. That doesn't mean you can go fishing and meet God just like you can meet him here. We're going to talk about that in a second. But God's there. How can you not sit on a lake or on a mountain peak and admire the beauty and the presence of God? Well, let me tell you, when you're in your car, God's there. If you're in your office, at school, wherever you are, when you come into Sunday school and you're sitting in a Sunday school class, God's there. When you walk into this sanctuary, God is in this place. We're talking the omnipresence of God. You can't get away from him. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that good news? But can I tell you, it gets better? It goes beyond that. When we look at Scripture, it goes further than that. There's another form of the presence of God, and that is the manifest presence of God. I love the way Don Cousins puts it in his book, Unexplainable. He said, God wants to do, listen to this, God wants to do the inconceivable, the uncommon, the unexpected, the remarkable, the incomprehensible. Why? So that he, God, is the only explanation for what occurs in our lives. Think about that. God wants to do something in such a way that you can't say, look what I did. That we can't brag about how good we are and how much we have to offer. God wants to do it in such a way, in such an inconceivable, unexplainable way, that He is the only one that can get the glory for it. Take a second, don't raise your hand, but take a second and inventory your life. Is that happening in your life? Is that a reality in your life? Is God doing things in your life that can only be explained by the fact that God's doing it? Otherwise, it wouldn't work. You put it on paper and it won't work out. We've been talking about tithing lately. You write it down. How many times have you heard on the videos, we did it on paper and it didn't work, but God worked it out. God took care of it. That's God working. He says, that is who God is. That's what God wants to do. Doesn't it sound wonderful to be in the care of a God that wants to do something greater than you can do yourself? And do you realize that part of the prayer when Jesus taught us how to pray deals with that? Every time we pray, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Do you realize that's what we're praying? Think about it. It's not a secret formula. It's not some kind of hocus-pocus words in a prayer that we say to conjure up the activity of God or to make things more spiritual. No, what we're literally asking God to do is to do here and now, in this very place, in this time, in this space, exactly what you're doing continuously in heaven. We're petitioning for His manifest presence right here in this place, in this service, in this gathering of God's people. The manifest presence of God is God's active engagement. Aren't you glad He didn't speak the world into existence, get everything to spinning, and then walk off from it and say, boy, I'm tired. I've worked 6 days. I'm tired. I'm going to rest for all eternity. Y'all got it from here. No, He stays involved. He is working, and his manifest presence is His active engagement in this world. It is His volition to work. It is His express capacity to affect you and me and things. Working in such a way that we can't explain it. I want you to think back to Exodus chapter 3. Moses is on the backside of the wilderness. Now, wilderness, I think trees. The Bible says wilderness, it's talking desert. He's on the backside of the desert, taking care. Now, how'd you like to work for your father-in-law taking care of his animals? But that's what he's doing. He's out there with the flocks. He's taking care of them. He's out there doing the things that he would normally do. And guess what he was doing? He was walking along, caring for the flock, in the omnipresence of God. I don't think anybody would disagree with that. The presence of God, the omnipresence of God, the fact everywhere, all the time, Moses on the backside of the desert couldn't get away from God, couldn't be pushed so far out that he couldn't find God. God was there. But on that day, at that specific time, he looked over, and there was a bush burning. And he walked over closer. It drew his attention. And see, there's something about the out of the ordinary that will draw us to it. And he goes over, and as he gets close to that bush to investigate, God said, Moses, take your sandals off. You're standing on holy ground. What we've just read about, what we've just talked about, what we've just seen is the manifest presence of God. Not the omnipresence. God was there anyway. He was all over that backside of the desert. But in that moment, in that burning bush, it was the manifest presence of God that caused Moses to be told to take your shoes off your own holy ground. I want to ask you a question. What made the biggest difference in Moses' life? 40 years of walking in the omnipresence of God, or 15 minutes in the manifest presence of God? without a doubt. 15 minutes in the let me tell you, 40 years in the omnipresence of God, that's comforting, and that's awesome. But 15 minutes in the manifest presence of God is life-changing. Moses never got over it. It was something that changed his life. If you've ever had that opportunity to be in the manifest presence of God, to see God acting in such a way that you couldn't explain it, no one else could explain it, you will be like Moses was. God, do it again. God, do it again. Years later, as he led the children of Israel out of captivity, as he had gone up to be in the manifest presence of God again at Mount Sinai, come down, they were all down there worshiping idols. We wouldn't do that, right? Sure we would. Sure we would. We get substitutes for God all the time. Most of the time it's tied up in our own skin. But Moses comes down. God sees, Moses sees, here's these people worshiping the idol, and as this conversation that's going on, Moses is saying, God, show it to me again. God, I long for that manifest presence of you. Was it there? Did he get it? Well, there was that pillar of fire by night and that cloud by day that couldn't be explained any way other than the manifest presence of God. There was that rock that brought forth water when they were dying of thirst. And you say, yeah, but one of the times that was a problem. It was, because Moses did it the wrong way. We'll talk about messing things up in a minute, because we can mess up the manifest presence of God. You realize that. There was manna from heaven. How do you explain what is it falling out of the sky? That's what manna means. What is it? And then when they griped about that, because that's all they had, of course they were being nourished, God gave them quail. So much quail, you know, made them sick. But he provided for them. How do you explain the quail falling out of the sky? The manifest presence of God. It didn't stop there. He moved them into the promised land. He helped them defeat the enemy that was there. We go all the way through the Old Testament. We find the people of God from time to time there being that manifest presence of God when it's needed and when they call for it and when they're doing what needs to be done to have it. We find it in the early church. God doing things that couldn't be explained. We find it all through the New Testament. And we don't have to write a New Testament, as Davis said. Folks, we're still living in New Testament times, and if we'll do our part, and if we'll give God praise, and if we'll come expecting, and we'll give him the glory, he will do things in our midst that can only be described as God has done something. And God gets the glory. It hasn't stopped. The potential is still here. God in his manifest presence. Moses expressed it like this in verse 18. Please, please let me see your glory. God agreed. Except he had a few things to add to it. Isn't that just the way God does it? Verse 18, Moses says, please let me see your glory. Now listen to what God says. I will cause my goodness to pass in front of you. I will proclaim the name of Yahweh before you. I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious, and I will have compassion on whom I have compassion. But he answered, you cannot see my face, for no one can see me and live. The Lord said, here is a place near me. You stand on this rock, And when my glory passes by, I will put you in the crevice of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will take my hand away and you will see my back, but my face will not be seen." I love the way that James MacDonald puts it here. He describes God's reply this way: "Stand back, Moses. Brace yourself if you can, but it's not going to matter much. You're about to be taken completely apart." See, when the manifest presence of God, when the glory of God falls, it will take us apart and then rebuild us. It will remove those things that are not to be in our lives. It will make you cannot be in the presence of God, in the manifest presence of God, with the glory of God falling. You cannot be in that place and ever be the same again. It will cause transformation. You will be a different person. See, when transcendence comes near, when the manifest presence of God comes near, it is the reality of the glory of God. When transcendence comes near, the glory of God comes. When we say your glory, that's literally translated your weight. God, bring your weight into this point. God, bring your weight. It carries the idea of your significance, your scope, your capacity. God, bring everything you've got to bear on this place at this time. God, bring your glory. Now, you want to shake a building. You want to have the feeling of an earthquake. You want to change things up. You want to mix things up. Get the glory of God falling in our midst. And we can't stand. We'll have to pull our shoes off. We'll end up face down before God because He'll be doing something that we can't touch. Jonathan Edwards defines the glory of God as God's infinite knowledge, His infinite holiness, His infinite joy, His infinite happiness. As a matter of fact, how do you separate God's glory from God? And you can't. Glory is to God what cold is to ice. Glory is to God what wet is to water. Moses said, and I'll paraphrase here, "God, if your presence, God, if your glory doesn't go with us, don't make us go. God, as exciting as it is, as awesome as this idea of a promised land is, if I've got to go without your presence, I'll choose not to go. God, it's your presence that demonstrates your favor on us, not the name on the sign. God, it's your presence that distinguishes us from all the others. Just go without your presence. Don't make us go without your glory." What a statement. I'm afraid that sometimes we're so all full steam ahead that we're willing to go. We're willing to do whatever we think needs to be done. And we're willing to do it whether the glory of God goes or not. How frightening. How frightening to be trying to do the Christian life or trying to do church outside of the manifest presence of God, of the glory of God. I think it's time to stop hiding behind the omnipresence of God and acting like it's the same thing as the manifest presence of God. And I'm not downplaying the omnipresence of God at all. But I'm afraid we've gotten so used to that, to the idea that, yeah, when we come to church, God's here. He was here before we got here. He'll be here when we leave. We're in God's presence. But that omnipresence of God was not what Moses found at the burning bush experience. It was not what changed his life. See, just because we meet together in the church building in the omnipresence of God doesn't mean we're experiencing the manifest presence of God or the glory of God. Think about this one. If the presence of God in our church on Sunday morning is the same thing as the presence of God in this church building on Saturday night when the air conditioning's not running, the lights are off, we've got a problem. It ought to be different. We ought to want it to be different. Could that maybe be why the world's not attracted? The world's not seeing what God can do and only God can do. The world's seeing what a group of people who can come together and agree on some things and work it out and we can do in our own strength. But we're not seeing what God can do. They're not seeing what God can do because we're satisfied with the omnipresence of God that I don't want to do without. But there's got to be more. Show me your glory. Think about this. We come together to worship. What is real worship without the glory of God? The Bible says that God inhabits our praise. If we're giving Him the glory, if we're worshiping God, if we're lifting praise to God, whether it be through music, through prayer, through preaching, and expecting that presence of God to fall, we can't do real worship without the manifest presence of God, without the glory of God, because He's the only one that's worthy of praise and worship. And He's the one that says that if you lift Him up and that he will draw men to Himself, He's the one that says that He inhabits the praise. Oh, when we gather together, we need to have the glory of God. It's powerful. But can I give you a warning? It is also fragile. We must understand that our actions do affect the manifest presence of God. We don't control it, but we affect it. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 5, 23 and 24, So if you're offering your gift on the altar and there you remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there in the front of the altar. First go, be reconciled with your brother, and then come and offer your gift. Did He tell us that just so we'd feel better? Just so there would be a little unity in the body? No, I think He said that because God knows very well that anger and hatred and those kinds of things in our heart directly affect the glory of God, the manifest presence of God. For us to come to worship, for us to sing and pray and go through all the steps. Now, we can have anger, we can have hatred, we can have all kinds of things in our heart, and the omnipresence of God is still here. But folks, the manifest presence of God is directly affected by that. That's why we need to make sure that we're right with our brothers and sisters in Christ. That's why we need to make sure we're right with God, because He wants to invade this place. He wants to do a great work. And we sometimes, by our attitudes, we affect adversely the presence of God. We hinder worship. Isaiah 59:2. But your iniquities have built barriers between you and your God, and your sins have made Him hide His face from you. Psalm 66:18. The psalmist says, if I had been aware of malice in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Could that be the reason answers to prayer is not coming? Now, I know sometimes God says maybe, and sometimes He says wait, and sometimes He says no. But if God's not answering, should we not first say, God, is there something that's separating me and you? Is there something in my life that's wrong that I need to correct, that I need to ask forgiveness for, so your presence can be here? So our sin can disrupt the manifest presence of God. But also, things we do that disrupt the work of the Holy Spirit can cause problems, even if it's unintentional. I don't think very often in church people come in and go, let me see if I can stir up some trouble today. Let me see if I can divert attention today. But we do things not meaning to, not thinking about it, that can cause problems with the working of the Holy Spirit, the manifest presence of God. Now, when I'm going to say what I'm about to say, I'm not trying to be an old maid school teacher that's just going to slap your hands, okay? That's not at all what I'm meaning. And I say this with all the love I know how to say it with. But folks, unnecessary movement in the church, in the service, can affect what God's doing in our midst. And I'm not saying this because it distracts me. I am the least person to be distracted. I can tell you, I've had people come to me and say, man, I'm sorry, Johnny. You know, Johnny, he's crying all through the service. I didn't hear it. I'm pretty focused when I get up here. But here's what I am concerned about. I'm concerned about the working of the Spirit in this place. Now, I understand there are emergencies sometimes. I get it. And I'm not talking about that. But can I ask you a favor? Get your drink of water and go to the bathroom before you come in. Because see, it's when we're here. You say, well, what's the big deal? We're standing and we're all singing. I won't even pick on the preaching. We're standing and we're all singing. Who will notice? I probably won't. But when the Spirit of God is working on someone's life and he's drawn their attention to him, let me tell you what Satan's looking for. Any distraction. Anything to draw your attention away. And so what I'm concerned about is the Spirit being broken. Is someone that is in the process of moving toward a decision that has eternal consequences, and Satan will use something as little as someone getting up and walking out, and everybody's attention turns, and the Spirit's broken. That person has used that to not make a decision today. Folks, if an emergency happens, everybody understands. We have some every week. Every church has people every week that come in and they are on emergency call. Been there, done that. I appreciate the fact that if you're on call, you come anyway. But do us a favor. If you know there's that chance of being called out, sit close to an exit. And if you get called out, just slip out that exit. Understanding that the Spirit of God, the movement of God, the glory of God, the presence of God, yes, it's powerful, but it can be quenched just like that. And we need to be careful of that. Now, I'm no way implying that I don't want children in this room. Don't you ever let anybody tell you that. I'll never forget a service that we were in years ago in another church, and we were doing the Lord's Supper. It was a candlelight service, and place was packed, and there were children. There was no nursery that night. There were children crying all over the place. And I had a person come up to me, and she said, "Why can't you keep those kids out of here?" And I said, "Let me tell you something. The Lord's Supper is family time. It's supper time. We're with Dad. And let me tell you something, those kids are just as welcome to the table as anybody else." So I'm not saying that I don't want children. I want more children. It doesn't bother me. We have chapel church, and that's great. But if we didn't, I'd love to have them sitting right here. I think they need to sit here more than we think they need to sit here. Not because I've got so much to say and they can understand everything I'm talking about, but the Holy Spirit, here we go again, the Holy Spirit of God has a way of going right into those hearts and taking something that they couldn't have repeated to me if they had to, but God worked in their life and they accepted Christ. So I don't think we have to have children's church. We have it, and that's great. But I love children. I love people. I want to see God working in ways that I can't explain and that you can't explain. And I don't want any of us to do anything that would at all break what God is doing and stop what God is doing in our midst. Now let me finally say this to anybody that takes these five steps and ends up right here. Whether you're preaching, singing, playing an instrument, or doing anything else, folks, the only difference on this floor and that floor is the height of it. It has nothing to do with your ability, with your skills, when you're in this room. In other words, when you're here, when I'm here, my whole role is to point people to Him. Not to point people to myself. Not to say, look how good I am at putting this together. And didn't He put it together in such a way that it flowed with the outline? Who cares? Not to be able to play an instrument to say, wow, what? Now I'm not saying I don't like instruments. I love them. But they can be played for the glory of God. And when we sing to the glory of God. It's not about us. Our choir's not as good as another one. Who cares? God says it's a sweet sound in His ear. It's about praising God. So if what we do here in any spot takes away from the glory of God, that's why I think we ought to do it the best we can. That's why I work real hard studying all week long. If I wasn't worried about that, I'd just come up here and read this to you. I got the whole manuscript, except I change it all the time. But I've got it all written out. I could just get up here and monotone read it to you. Dare I make worship boring? If God is a God of power, if God is a God of glory that wants to do something, dare I stand here and make it so boring that we can't wait to get out? Absolutely not. God wants to do something in our midst, and I don't want to do anything that would take away from it. And we've got to understand as leaders, whether in music or speech or anything else or prayers. Listen, I've heard some pretty big shows in prayers. We've got to understand that it's not us. I don't care how many big words you can use. I don't care how many these and thous you can throw in. Doesn't matter. I don't care what version you read from in most cases. And I don't care what the songs are as long as it's bringing glory to God and asking for His glory to fall in this place. You say, how do you keep it from being about you? You have to remember James chapter 4. God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves before the Lord. Folks, I want to see the glory of God. I am so thankful for His omnipresence. Because of His omnipresence, we can have church members traveling this weekend and we just know they're in the presence of God. Kim, Carl, you guys are coming back from Tennessee. Man, when you're traveling, we know God, you're in His presence. The omnipresence of God is great. But the manifest presence of God, the glory of God, it's what I want to happen so that when people look at my life, I can't explain it. When people look at this church, we can't explain it. When they are here, they say, I don't know what it was, but man, God's doing something. And you know what that does? That draws me back every week. That draws me back saying, God, do it again. Man, can we agree together that we'll say, God, we don't want to worship anymore without your glory? God, we don't want to do ministry anymore without your glory. God, we don't want to just attend church anymore without your glory. God, where we are when we're doing it, we want your glory and your honor, and we want you to do something that can only be explained by the fact that you did it. What a time we'll have together. What a time we'll have worshiping him. And he will draw people to himself.